And sold to number 117, the lovely lady in the fur coat, for $100,500. Our next item up for bid is this rare emerald-colored ring. Its material and gemstone are unknown. All that is known about this mysterious piece of jewelry is that it was pulled from the Caspian Sea some years prior. We'll start the bidding at $100,000. I have $100,000. Do I hear $100,100? $100,100. $100,500. Very good, $100,500. Dare I say $1,100,000?
In a ritzy auction house in Vienna, Austria, a small aristocratic crowd has gathered to view the various fancy wares up for sale. Items up for bidding include an authentic Ming Dynasty vase, a page from Leonardo da Vinci's own private journal, and currently a shiny green ring, presumably only for show. A man with long black hair and a suit and tie knows differently, however, as he continually raises his paddle in silence. One particularly avid collector is also unrelenting with his paddle, watching the long-haired man with annoyance. The price has gotten steep.
$7,500,000. Do I hear $7,500,000? Very good!
They're the only two in the battle.
The price raises to $1,000,000. Gentlemen, we have $1,000,000! $1,500,000?
The collector hesitates, starting to believe that he is in an unwinnable fight. There will be other pieces. He surrenders.
Going once, going twice, and sold to number 50, the man with the long hair!
Three down, seven to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining me in another special episode of Late at Night with McDaniel. I, of course, am your charismatic host, Glenn McDaniel, here with an exceptional guest, the CEO of Stark Industries, the one and only Tony Stark!
Thank you, and thank you for having me here tonight, Glenn.
Please, the pleasure's all mine, especially after that disaster of a show with Stephen Grant last week. What a riot, huh? So, Tony, as you're aware, your company was absolutely bombing just last year. Heck, even HammerTech was beating you. You remember when they tried to go into TV dinner manufacturing? Cardboard would have tasted better.
Yes, last year wasn't our finest hour, but we're doing much better.
I'll say you are. There's not a single publication out there right now without your face on it. The arc reactors are selling better than hotcakes. Your public image is soaring, too. People either want to be you or be with you. Can you guess which one I am?
McDaniel turns to the camera and smiles as he unbuttons his shirt, revealing another with the face of Tony Stark on it.
Yes, I think we all know exactly which one you are.
Glenn winks at the crowd.
Now, Tony, let's talk about the Iron Man for a moment here. See, I love talking about stocks as much as the next schmuck, but Tony, Iron Man has impacted the city perhaps even more than the arc reactors have. Just the other day, I was out getting a sub from Louis on 31st, and woof! Right overhead comes Iron Man flying like a bat out of hell, here to save the day again. I'm sure all of us New Yorkers are glad to have him protecting the city, right, folks? So, tell us, who is the man behind the Iron Man? Or woman?
Now that I can't say without risking Iron Man's life, but know this, they are possibly the most heroic person I've ever met. They're willing to sacrifice anything for all you good people. You can always count on Iron Man. In fact, you can help Iron Man, too. Stark Industries set up an Iron Man hotline. Call or text anytime you see criminal activity, and he'll be there pronto. 1-800-ARM-RD-SAVIOR today.
Tony, you are one in a million.
One in a billion, actually.
Does that mean there are six other Tony Starks we haven't met?
Did someone tell you about our cloning experiments in the basement?
This guy. Tony Stark, ladies and gentlemen.
Laying it on a little thick, aren't you?
The only words that come out of my mouth are the truth, Pepper.
Bullshit!
Catching a cold there?
Obadiah says he wants to see you as soon as possible. Something about a board meeting with a company from Japan.
Tell him I'll be there as soon as I can.
So, never, right?
I've got more important things right now.
Like showing off?
Exactly.
Ugh, come on, you're going to be late for your next meeting.
Next up, the illegal gun epidemic sweeping through New York City. How to know if your gun is legal, and where to avoid.
A jet-black Audi A6 pulls up fastly to the towering slate building with huge chrome letters proudly exclaiming Oscorp Industries. Tony fixes his hair and hops out of his car just as a serious-faced, ginger-haired businessman strolls out. His strong face softens the instant he sees Tony, even breaking into a smile.
Stark! Good to finally see you. How long has it been?
Too long, Osborn. Last time I saw you, Harry was still asking for piggyback rides.
If he did now, he'd break my back.
The two old friends shake each other's hands, both men grinning larger than they have in a long time.
Tried to get a hold of you a while ago. That secretary of yours said you were on a vacation?
Yeah, that was an interesting vacation. I spent some time in England. Wow, it's been a while since I've seen this place. Pretty impressive. At least compared to Hammertech, that is.
The years have been kind to Oscorp. Hey, remember when we tried building a rocket engine in your garage? Found that picture your dad took of us all those years ago. Doom as a genius is constantly tracking grease around.
Of course I do. No one could forget a scolding from your father. What a pair we were.
I'm not sure what he was complaining about. I rebuilt his car better than any lazy New York mechanic could have.
Only to wreck it on prom night a few years later.
What can you do? Those were the days. But look at us now, though. We made it.
Boy, did we ever. But I'm pretty sure Stark Stock is beating Oscorp right now.
Stark Industries is a 0.50 from Oscorp as of 1:55 p.m.
See, you haven't changed. Oscorp will catch up. Give us a day. Your arc reactors are hard to beat, however. I can't believe you're giving us hours for free. You do know we can afford it, right?
Hey, I figured it's the least I could do. You could have easily bought out Stark Industries last year before the arc reactor.
I couldn't let Howard's legacy be absorbed and die. That man was more of a father to me than my own dad.
Yeah, he was great.
Tony, believe me when I say, he'd be proud of everything you're doing.
Thanks, Norman.
Alert, sir. You have a last-minute appointment.
Ah, shit. I better get out of here. I've got a date. My boys will take care of the installation. I trust them with my life. You're in good hands.
A date? At 2 p.m.? With who?
Stilt-Man has returned! And this time, I'm not alone!
The Unicorn is here to steal all your money, and no one is powerful enough to stop us.
And I thought Thor had lame bones.
On a panic street of downtown New York City, Iron Man fires a repulsive blast down at Stilt-Man and the Unicorn's feet.
Only warning, put your hands up now and turn yourself in, or this gets ugly.
I'll show you ugly, shellhead!
Stilt-Man ascends up rapidly and punches Iron Man, sending him backwards.
Alright then, you asked for it.
Iron Man aims a repulsive blast at Stilt-Man's legs, but is hit by a laser from the Unicorn's head, scorching his right shoulder and causing his shot to crash into the pavement below instead of hitting its mark.
What the hell?
That's right. Everyone witness me. I'm stronger than you.
The Unicorn's helmet is hit by a repulsive blast and short circuits. Iron Man dodges another arm-extended punch from Stilt-Man as he flies down to the Unicorn and gives him a hard wop straight to the face, knocking him out before his body even touches the ground.
And as for you?
Iron Man activates his wrist laser and slices through Stilt-Man's flimsy legs, sending him cascading down, landing right next to the Unicorn.
This was
thank you. Please, it was nothing. These guys are the true heroes.
Iron Man lands down on the pavement as the NYPD do their job, taking Stilt-Man out of his metal suit and cuffing the pair of villains, roughly shoving them into the back of his squad car. Iron Man continues to wave at his adoring fans. Tony starts smiling underneath his helmet for every second of it. Police Detective Yuri Watanabe walks up to the armored Avenger, not looking nearly as happy.
Ah, Detective Wasabi, looking as lovely as ever. Are you wearing new makeup?
It's Watanabe. And how many times do I have to tell you not to fire your fancy lasers in the city? Do you realize how much damage they cause, or worse, could cause if you hit a bystander?
Relax, Detective. See? Everyone's fine. I did like 90% of your job for you, so you should be happy.
Happy to see rampant escalation in my streets? All because we have you now? We had enough troubles dealing with normal criminals. Now we have a bunch of costumed loonies like these two causing a panic.
But now you have me to stop them. Just go file your paperwork or whatever you do. Citizens?
Iron Man nods to the crazed crowd and flies off into the car, not looking back at Detective Watanabe and his squad.
But what happens when you're not here?
Ungrateful?
Sir, I've been filtering through all of the Iron Man hotline calls for pertinent information. There seems to be a fair amount of Seymour Butts living in New York, sir.
Of course there are. Anything useful yet?
We got an anonymous report that alas reveals more information on your current illegal arms shipment case.
Finally. Give it to me, Jarvis.
The report states that they witnessed suspicious activity on Governor's Island. People with their faces covered unloading crates early in the morning. They said the men are working like clockwork as well, their shipment always arriving at 4:39 a.m. on the dot. Though there is nothing here about what is in the crates, this is the best information we have uncovered so far.
Well, Jarvis, looks like we're going to Governor's Island. You think that hot dog place is still there?
Unfortunately, sir, it closed down due to poor health ratings in 2019.
Damn it! How can I fight crime on an empty stomach?
Marino's Pizza is still open on Governor's Island, sir.
Marino's it is. Then we'll stop the arms shipment.
Iron Man sets off in a blaze to the location on his HUD in Governor's Island, excited that he finally has a lead after weeks of silence. Meanwhile in France, however, another man isn't having as good of a day. In fact, he's been running into a streak of endless misfortune.
Come on, again? I swear, after this, I'm moving out of this hellhole. Can't people just leave me the hell alone?
Aldrich Killian finds his French mana under attack yet again, but this time, however, from even deadlier foes than before. The man leading the attack looks average, with a simple suit and tie on his person and not even a thread of armor. The magic that he wields is quite destructive. One woman walks behind him with a gun, firing off shots with surgical precision. Though she is otherwise a stunning figure, the fire in her eyes makes the assassin terrifying. The long-haired man floats into the compound with a green magical shield surrounding him, his latest prize from the Austrian auction house on his finger. He stretches the guards in panic try to shoot through his shield, but the bullets just evaporate.
Enough!
The man sends out a disc of energy, cutting through the guards as if they were nothing. The dreaded carnage riddles the floor as they all slump down in a large flood. Killian stands at the end of the hallway, horror-struck and frozen. The killer glides over his mess straight to Killian. Aldrich shakily picks up a fallen gun and points it at the man when he reaches him.
Please, just stay back. I don't want any trouble.
The woman points a firearm at his head, but doesn't pull the trigger. The man flips the gun out of Killian's hand without magic.
Don't worry, Killian. I'm only going to kill you if you don't do as I say. You recognize these, yes?
The man holds up his hand and shows the shaky Killian his three magical rings. Killian's eyes widen, and the man smirks again, knowing that he had the right idea coming here. Killian gives his confirmation with a nervous nod.
Take me to yours, and this will all be over.
Killian, knowing he doesn't have any choice if he wants to live, leads the way as quickly as possible, not looking back to see if the man is following, but feeling his presence all the same. A few turns around the hallway bends brings the two to a large vault, the very same the God of Mischief and Hydra took their prize in a year prior. Without being told, Killian unlocks the door in a hurried speed and opens it before his unwelcome guests. Killian and his organization's treasure are now in full view. Aldrich waves a hand for the man to enter, and he nods his appreciation. The powerful figure glances at all the vault has to offer, taking his time and eyeing everything curiously. He notes artifacts stolen from Asgard's gilded halls, ancient dark elven weapons from battles long ago, scrolls holding old knowledge, even original paintings dating back to the Renaissance. The woman, however, keeps her eyes firmly on Killian.
My word, you have quite the impressive collection, Mr. Killian. Is this real?
The man takes a vibranium dagger off of its pedestal and holds it closer to himself. Killian simply nods nervously again, and the man places it back to where it belonged, turning his attention back to his quest. He spots something glowing out of the corner of his eye and turns towards it. At last, he has found his trophy. Another ring lies prominently in a glass container.
This is the first time it has glowed, yes?
Yes. It's never done that.
Then that proves my source is correct, then. This is authentic. Tell me of how you came upon this ring.
The invader picks up the glass box and examines the ring while Killian explains his history with it.
Well, my organization has always had a, well, keen interest in powerful objects, and I made it my mission to track down whatever I can. It belonged to a museum in Berlin before my organization, well...
Stole it, yes. Do you know of its history before then?
Only what was known by the museum curator. that it was once Clovis's, that he,
I'm aware of Clovis and his unification. Good, very good. My source was more accurate than I thought. This helps me with my search.
Search?
Surely you've heard of the legend of the Ten Rings.
No, I wasn't aware there were any more until you showed up.
And you call yourself a curator? Many centuries ago, a meteorite crashed down into China during the Qin Dynasty. The element at its core was unknown to man, and much about it today still remains a mystery. The man who found it felt power surging through his body inexplicably, and decided to use it to turn a profit. Once the Emperor caught wind of it, it was confiscated. The Emperor too felt its power, and ordered it to be crafted into rings. 10 were forged. The Emperor kept 5 for himself, but gifted the rest to his top generals to expand the Qin Dynasty. Qin Shi Huang himself used the power of the rings to seize much land around the Qins. After the fall of the Qin Dynasty, the rings popped up during several different points in history before going into hiding once again. Clovis's unification of the Franks, the North American Revolution, the Napoleonic Wars, and now one has found its way to you, and from you to me.
The man carefully opens the glass box and takes out the shining ring. He slides it onto his finger next to the other 3 and closes his eyes, feeling even stronger now.
No one knows what happens when someone possesses all 10 of the rings, but I will be the first to find out.
Killian backs away from the man a little out of fear, but doesn't act. It would have been all too easy to pick up one of his weapons and attack the man, but he knew he couldn't win.
And now, Mr. Killian, I need your help once again. You see, the rings have fallen through the cracks of history, and though I've spent what seems like a lifetime trying to track them all down, I still haven't the slightest clue where most of them lie. With you and your AIM, however, I have a feeling you'll make my hunt far easier. How about you assist me?
Killian thinks for a moment, knowing if he answers wrongly, it will cost him his life.
Well, as advanced as my organization is, we could try, but I can't guarantee results. But I know someone who's better suited for this. Someone that could find the rings, given the, proper motivation.
And who would that be?
Tony Stark.
The man thinks for a moment, staring at Killian while considering his options. A bead of sweat slides down Aldrich's face as his increased breathing becomes more noticeable.
Then it is time I finally meet Tony Stark. I will let you live out of the goodness of my heart. I truly don't enjoy killing. However, should you tell anyone of what transpired here, you will force my hand, and there is nowhere on earth in which you can hide from me. Take this as reimbursement for the ring and all of the trouble.
The Mandarin pulls out a check from his pocket and writes a sum of $5 million on it. He rips it out of his checkbook and hands it to Killian before brushing past him and walking out of the vault. The woman lags behind for a moment, shoving Aldrich Killian into one of the shelves and quickly taking the vibranium blade. She presses it against Killian's throat, with just enough pressure for him to feel it, but not enough to make him bleed.
And it's not the Mandarin who will deal with you. It'll be me. Trust me, I do enjoy killing.
Matsumoto, come.
The woman with the fiery eyes stares at the pale Killian for a moment, before taking the blade off of his throat and joining the Mandarin. Together, they walk past the mess they created and out into the gathering morning of Bordeaux victoriously, but with more work to be done.
I want you to handle Stark for me, but discreetly. I need your word no blood will be spilled.
Of course, sir. I have other ways.
Back in New York, Iron Man stands just out of sight of the warehouse. Suspicious activity has been reported, watching with his new drone and waiting for the perpetrators to get caught in the act. Iron Man's been there for a few hours now, and Tony begins to feel massively bored. This is the part of superhero life he didn't fancy.
Penny for your thoughts, Jarvis.
As an AI, sir, I do not have thoughts, only computings. Nor do I have any need for currency.
Good point.
What about you, sir? What is on your mind?
Dad's been on my mind. So much recently. Especially after seeing Norman. What would he think of all this? I mean, he designed the suit. I'm sure he never imagined his son being the one to pilot it.
Well, sir, despite seeing humanity at its worst, he believed in the good of people. He didn't want his Iron Man project to be used by the military. So I know that he would be proud of his son for taking the initiative to put himself at risk for the greater good.
What if Watanabe is right, though? What if I'm causing more harm than good? I mean, Crimson Dynamo would have never existed if I didn't become Iron Man.
But think of the lives you've saved, sir. What matters now is that you are here. You cannot change that fact. If you leave, there'll be even more dire consequences. The city needs you, sir.
You're right. It does. It needs me more than anyone else.
Iron Man notices some movement on the drone's camera and nearly jumps with excitement. He zooms in closer and uses the drone to scout out the area before launching into action. He carefully notes the positions of each of the thugs, all of them armed with either a pistol or an assault rifle. Most of them are down on the ground floor of the warehouse, but two patrol the upper scaffolding. Tony knows that his suit can withstand anything that they throw at him, but he needs to be careful. He needs information, not a bunch of dead goons.
Jarvis, suggestions? This tin can isn't exactly stealthy. I need to remember to fix that sometime.
Your typical strategy of going in guns blazing could work, but there is a risk of destroying potential evidence and leads. The optimal strategy would be to split them up and to take them out as quickly and quietly as possible. What I suggest a distraction, sir?
I'm all ears.
Perhaps a demonstration. I take control of the drone and fly directly into the warehouse.
I mean, come on! Are you sure you won't go out with me? We know each other's names, after all. No one else does.
Don't you dare say my name out loud. I know I shouldn't have told you.
Okay. And what if I do? How about this? I don't tell everyone your name, and you go on a date with me.
How about this? You don't tell everyone my name, and you don't get a bullet in your head.
Jeez, alright, I was just... Wait, do you hear that?
I fly the drone fiercely into the head of the male thug, sending him crashing down into the crate.
Holy shit, boys, we got company. Some sort of police drone thing.
The female thug fires a machine gun wildly at the air, trying to take out the drone. I, however, am far too quick for it to even remotely get close. Your distraction, sir.
Jarvis, you're magnificent.
In all of the chaos, Iron Man flies through the back end and lands on the scaffolding above, sticking to the shadows as best he can.
Jesus Christ! Watch it down there for the shooting! You're gonna hit one of us! Or even worse, you'll damage the merch!
Sorry, we gotta take this thing out, though. And quick, I'm sure it's got a camera, and I don't know about you, but I really don't want to get arrested today.
Fine, just...
Just what? Hello? Idiot.
I fly up to the top level and sneak behind another guard to take him out with an electric shock before he even notices me. His body crumbles down to the scaffolding just as Iron Man walks out of the shadows.
Damn it, Jarvis! I was just about to do that. Get your own thugs.
Must everything be a competition with you, sir?
Yes.
I fly the drone back down to the lower level as the remaining four thugs paranoidly scan the area for their attacker. Heart rate's high.
It's gotta be here somewhere. Keep an eye out for any movement.
Who the hell put you in charge?
Who the hell made you a jackass? Follow my lead and you'll... Shit!
Iron Man descends down from the rafters to meet the last four goons, one of them dropping their weapon in shock. So much for the stealthy approach.
Put down the guns and nobody'll get hurt. Why does nobody ever listen to me?
Iron Man launches into attack, punching the goon with his metal gauntlet and knocking them out cold. Tony turns around and raises his hand at the other goon, ready to fire an electric shock when they quickly aim and hit his glove, shattering the report.
Shit!
I got him!
Iron Man backhands her and she's sent sprawling into their cargo. Taking notes of her, another thug aims their gun at the sentinel spot in Iron Man's armor, his arc reactor in the center of his chest.
Oh no you don't!
Iron Man fires a concentrated energy blast at the henchman's gun, melting it before his eyes. He drops the gun painfully, and I ram the drone into him. One remaining. I fly right behind him and keep my electric shock ray trained on him while Iron Man holds his functioning repulsor at his head.
Drop it now, or you'll lose your head. Literally.
Defeated, the thug drops his pistol. Iron Man takes off the man's black mask and looks at the sweaty and shaky man in the eyes.
Let's see what you're importing here.
Tony steps away from the man for a moment and breaks open a crate. He's not surprised to see a slew of weapons stream out, but is, however, shocked when he gets a look at who manufactured them.
Wait, these? They're Stark Industries weapons. How the hell did you get these?
I don't know much, okay? This is a need-to-know operation. I don't even know who my boss is. I get paid to keep my head down and not ask questions.
Then what do you know? Better start thinking fast. I'm not a patient man.
The shipments, they're always from somewhere in China, directly from the manufacturer.
Stark Industries doesn't have any manufacturers in China anymore.
Check again.
Who's running this factory?
Like I said, I don't know who my boss is, just that he's the head of the organization.
What organization?
The Ten Rings. Please, that's all I know. Just let me-
Iron Man shoots him with an electric shock, and he tumbles down with the rest of his crew. Tony stands there upset for a moment. Someone was using not only his name, but his father's too, for their horrible deeds.
How the hell did this happen? We shut down the weapons division last year. Jarvis, what do you know about the Ten Rings?
Searching now, sir.
According to numerous sources, they are a terrorist organization based in China. Not much is known about their operations, except for that they were responsible for small cyber attacks in France a few months prior.
And now they're stealing my name. We have to stop this now. There has to be someone on the inside of all this. I need to talk to Obi. Jarvis, can you repair the damage to my left repulsor?
Almost complete now, sir. I finished up the last bits of repair on the Iron Man suit, quickly patching up Tony's repulsor. I give it a quick check, and then Tony zips out of the warehouse, on his way to Stock Industries expeditiously. We land down in an empty back alleyway, and Tony quickly steps out of the Iron Man suit. As he does, I call one of his cars to our current location, and it speeds out of the manor's garage, likely shocking a few people when they see a sleek sports car barreling down the road without a driver. A red Porsche 911 arrives just outside the alleyway, and Tony hops into the driver's seat as I pack up the Iron Man suit in the trunk. He takes off urgently for Stock Industries, and before long he pulls into the lot and takes his usual parking spot. He rushes in, not even so much as saying hi to any of his employees, including Happy Hogan.
Oh, there you are, Mr. Stark. Have you had a chance to read any of my emails yet? I wasn't sure if you were getting them, so I sent about 20, just in case. But the new security system is finally up and it's running.
Great. Look, Happy, I'm kind of busy right now. We can talk about everything later.
Of course, Mr. Stark. Sir, it's just that every time you say later, it's a...
Why isn't the elevator working?
Oh, yeah. Sir, that's actually part of the new security system. You see, you need a specialized card and the daily key code. Now, I actually thought of the new system myself, and I was reading a lot lately about different articles about talking about high-tech companies and how they go about their security in this digital age that we're going into. And it's really interesting stuff. Now, they really can't reveal too much to their audience, otherwise they're...
Happy, the elevator, please.
Oh, sorry, Mr. Stark. I'd like to see the angry Iron Man rip-off guy get past that.
Yes, I'm sure a keypad could definitely withstand a repulsor blast.
Thank you, sir. I really appreciate that. I thought the same thing myself. It's all about the integrity and imagination. Okay, back to work.
Tony impatiently taps the elevator button again. After what seems like an eternity of waiting, while Tony's mind still processes everything he's heard from the thug in the warehouse, the elevator at last arrives to the top floor. Mr. Stark steps off of it and runs straight for Mr. Stane's office, nearly running over a mail carrier in the process.
Tony, there you are. I've been trying to reach you for days. You ever check your phone?
Obi, whatever it is, it can wait. We've got a serious problem.
Fine. But if we talk about your thing, will you promise me you'll find time for a board meeting?
It's a deal.
Huh. I think this is the first time I've ever seen you come up here without a bottle of scotch with you. This must be serious.
Stark Industries is still making weapons.
What are you talking about? I oversee everything we produce at our multiple sites. Right now, it's full steam ahead with your arc reactor initiative. Where is this coming from, anyways?
Iron Man. He's been tracking illegal weapons shipments coming into New York, and he just had a breakthrough. He found one of the import hubs, and it was loaded with Stark weapons.
Tony, look. There's still thousands, hundreds of thousands of our weapons out there from the past. It's probably not too hard to find caches of them around the world. It's great that Iron Man found some of them, but I can guarantee they're leftovers. We're not making weapons.
One of the thugs at the warehouse swore they were new and were being produced by someone in China. Our name, my name, is being used there.
And who's to say this person wasn't lying to throw Iron Man off the trail of some bigger weapons cache?
Take a look at this.
Tony sets his watch down on Obadiah's desk and opens up a file folder. He presents the images within it as a brief slideshow. First, the warehouse itself, then its contents. Several images of illegal weapons are laid out on the floor with their serial numbers clearly visible.
If you run the serial numbers, I assure you they're new, unproduced by us.
We'll run the numbers. You really believe all this, don't you?
Yes, obviously. The guy said some terrorist group was behind all of this. Have you ever heard of the Ten Rings?
Never, no. But if what you're saying is true, this is dangerous. Not only for the company, but everyone. Who knows what they could do with this level of manufacturing power?
That's why Iron Man is going to stop it. We need you too, though, Obi. You're our man on the inside.
What do you mean?
This couldn't just happen without some sort of connection. That's where you come in. I need you to find out how the Ten Rings is doing all of this. There's gotta be an inside man in Stark Industries, if not multiple.
And you want me to play detective and somehow find one person among 10,000?
Exactly. Jarvis can help you search through the files, too. They can't outsmart Stark Industries, Obadiah. They'll slip up eventually.
Well, my job just got a whole lot more difficult. I'll find your guy, Tony.
Thanks, Obi. I'll get out of your hair. Or lack of. And leave it to it. Call me if you find anything even remotely suspicious.
Of course. Oh, and Tony, don't forget about that meeting. Small tech company in Japan is looking for a buyout. They're sending a representative any day now.
Mm-hmm. Goodbye, Obi.
He's not going to that meeting, is he?
Tony heads back down to the lobby with a lot on his mind, plotting his next course of action and hoping Mr. Stane can help him narrow his search. When the elevator reaches the lobby, he steps out in a hurry, nearly running into a black-haired woman wearing a suit in the process.
Hey, watch it there, you... Oh, my goodness, Mr. Stark, I apologize.
It's my fault, really. I was in so much of a hurry, I wasn't even paying attention. Sorry, Miss...
Takahashi, but you can call me Anya. I'm the representative from Yokoyama Incorporated. You've been briefed about our meeting, yes?
Just now, in fact. I didn't realize they were sending a woman.
Is that a problem, Mr. Stark?
No, but look, I've got a lot going on right now. Could we maybe talk about this over dinner?
Dinner? As in a formal, strictly business meeting, or something else?
A little of both.
Are you asking me out on a date? I hardly seem worthy of that. I'm nothing like the girls you usually go out with. We get the tabloids in Tokyo, too.
On the contrary, you're far more beautiful than any of them.
What?
Except you, Samantha.
Well, I'm flattered. You're easy on the eyes, too. I wouldn't mind losing a few hours with you.
LaRusso's? 7:30?
I'll give you my address. Maybe you can stay around a little afterwards, too. If you're lucky.
Ms. Takahashi opens up a notebook, quickly scribbles down the address to her hotel, rips off the tab, and hands it to Tony with a wink.
See you later, handsome.
The lady walks off with a satisfied smile. The employees who saw their brief encounter assume she's excited for the date. The so-called Anya was happy about how her plan was going already. Across the way, Pepper Potts watches the whole thing with her arms crossed and quickly catches up to her boss.
You know, Tony, I've been looking into this company myself. It all seems a little sketchy. There's not much about them online. It says they were established back in the 80s, but there's hardly anything that they are publicly linked to. All their social medias were created fairly recently, too.
So?
So, just think before you agree to anything, all right?
Why do you care, Pepper?
I care about Stark Industries. Unlike you, apparently. I always research the companies every time interest in a merger comes up. They could be trying to swindle you into buying out a completely useless business and run away with the profits.
You weren't concerned about this before when you brought it up.
That's because I just started researching them.
It's because of Anya, isn't it?
What do you mean?
You know exactly what I mean. You're jealous, aren't you?
Jealous? Please, why would I be jealous of her?
Because she's got me right now and you're incredibly protective of me.
It's my job to look after you.
We've spent so much time together, Pepper. You can't deny that you haven't fallen for me. Why else wouldn't you have anyone in your life?
Who says I need anyone? You're a piece of shit, you know that?
Tony storms out of the building and doesn't look back. Pepper stands there for a moment, the whole lobby in stunned silence.
Well, the show's over! Stop staring at me!
Everyone quickly returns back to what they were doing as Pepper furiously walks outside to get a breath of fresh air. She sees Tony already almost to his car, but also notices Miss Takahashi, who is currently on the phone with her employer. Pepper carefully sneaks over to eavesdrop in on what she has to say, only hearing one side of the conversation.
All going to plan, sir. Tony Stark doesn't suspect a thing. We'll have him in our grasp soon.
Don't underestimate him, Lady Bullseye. He may be weak when it comes to women, but he's still incredibly intelligent. Do what you need to do fast before he catches on.
Of course, sir.
Pepper's eyes widen at the brief but revealing conversation. As quietly as she can, she walks back into the Stark Industries building. She doesn't go unnoticed, however, as Lady Bullseye gets a glimpse of her walking away. She smiles to herself. Now she has two targets. Pepper hurries to the elevator inside and stabs the button angrily a few times, wanting nothing but to hide in her office and do more research.
Come on, you piece of...
Miss Potts?
Hey, Happy. You saw all of that, didn't you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm sorry, Miss Potts. Believe me, I know how hard it is to deal with Mr. Stark. Did you know that I send him a Christmas card every year no matter what? I make sure that it's always different so it can turn out to be unique. Let him know that
I'm personally sending it to him, and I'm thinking about him during the holidays. But all I get is the standard old blank happy holidays card that, well, everyone else seems to get. I kinda thought we were becoming friends or something.
Happy, would you like to go on a date with me?
What? I'm sorry. Oh, yes, right. It's the 23rd.
What? No, Happy, I asked you out on a date, not what the date is.
Wait, I'm sorry. Are you asking... You're asking me out on a date as in like a date? Or a date as in two friends just going to the bar and talking about last night's game?
You haven't been on many dates, have you?
Well, actually... No. Nope.
Did you want to go to LaRusso's tonight?
LaRusso's? Isn't that place really hard to get into? Like, that's like expensive.
Not if you're Tony Stark's secretary. I'll meet you back here around 7, okay?
Yeah. yeah, I'll see you there. Then. I'll see you then, Miss Potts.
Happy walks back to his post, blushing and nearly stumbling over a wet floor sign. He smiles awkwardly back at Pepper, who smiles and waves at him just as the elevator doors open at last. He takes a lift back to her office and gets to work, digging up dirt on Yokoyama Incorporated and now Anya Takahashi. Meanwhile, Tony Stark hops into his red Porsche and zips back to his manor. He begins the search for the Ten Rings manufacturing plant as he drives, hardly focusing on the road ahead.
Jarvis, use all of our satellites to scan China. Look for elements specific to our weapons.
Sir, there are thousands of manufacturing plants in China. The likelihood of finding the exact culprit is exceedingly low.
But there's still a chance. Do it.
Yes, sir.
Are there any maps of Ten Ring activity in China?
What maps there are do not have much activity around the globe, let alone in China. But I will do a wide search and construct my own on various forums and news outlets. Perhaps they'll give us results when I cross-match the two.
Get to it.
Sir.
Did you find something already?
No, sir. It's a red light.
Oh, shit!
After 5 more minutes of driving, Mr. Stark at last arrives back at his home, bags under his eyes, but he refuses to let himself fall asleep, or until he saves his company and his reputation. When he walks in, he half expects Pepper to be waiting for him inside, but then remembers what happened just moments ago.
I've been a real dick, haven't I?
Which time, sir?
You know when, Jarvis. I'll deal with it later. First, we gotta find these bastards and punch a hole through their operation.
How right you are, sir. Tony walks down to the basement in a hurry, as I still compute all the data I am receiving from the Stark Industries satellites.
How long is this going to take?
Unknown, sir, but I'm allocating as much computing power as possible to it. Tony just nods, walking over to do his own research. Hours pass by as Tony reads through article after article on the Ten Rings, scrounging for any piece of useful information he can find.
God, doesn't anyone know about their leader?
Another hour passes, and Tony calls Mr. Stane for an update on his search, but he's finding as much as I am.
Nothing yet, Tony. I'll call you when I find something, alright?
Yeah, alright.
Have you gotten any sleep? You look like shit.
Keep searching, Obi.
Tony continues his tiring search, starting to get frustrated with the lack of progress he's made. He steps back and lets me continue my search, choosing instead to work on a different project, a new Iron Man suit. This time he's working on the concealability of it, trying to make a model that will fit into a briefcase. His business formal Iron Man suit, as he playfully called it. He currently works on soldering a few wires together on the chest plate, nearly burning himself in the process. Sir, I really recommend you going upstairs to your room and getting some sleep for a few hours.
What's the use? I won't be able to sleep. I can't stop thinking about these Ten Ring bastards.
Well, sir, you cannot do anything about them currently while we are trying to locate them. Would it not be better to fight them more aggressively? Mr. Stark ignores me as he continues working on Mark III's chest plate. It isn't long until Tony does fall asleep, whether he wanted to or not. He lays sprawled out on the floor with a soldering gun in his hand, dead to the world. A programmed alarm starts going off, but it isn't enough to wake him up. Mr. Stark, it is time for you to wake up. You need to get ready for your date. Or shall I inform Ms. Takahashi that you would like to reschedule?
Ah, shit.
That's plenty to wake him up. Tony throws down the soldering gun and runs straight for the master bathroom. He smells his shirt, and is a little repelled by it.
Jarvis, what time is it?
It is 6:57 now, sir.
Damn it. That's not enough time to take a shower. Alone it is.
Tony quickly changes into a sleek all-black suit and adds a splash of color with a red tie, douses himself in a pleasant-smelling cologne, and fixes his hair before giving his reflection a wink.
You have her address, right?
Indeed I do, sir.
Then let's do this.
Tony selects a black Lamborghini from his garage and zooms out in the darkening night.
I'm mildly surprised, sir, that you're not upset by these things.
How so, Jarvis?
Well, sir, it takes time from your current two projects. Projects you seem very adamant and concerned about.
It does, yes, but this is business. I can't let Obi down. Plus, I think I've earned a break, haven't I? Like you said, there's not much I can do right now while you process all of your data.
It's the company you're keeping, isn't it, sir?
Damn right it is.
Tony steps on the gas and soon finds Miss Takahashi's address, an elegant and grand-looking six-story hotel that stood in New York for several years, but by its appearance, it could have just been finished a week ago. While the state of the hotel they're able to afford, it appears as though Yomiyaka Incorporated is doing quite well for themselves. Mr. Stark doesn't pay any attention to this, however, as he spots his date. Miss Takahashi waits for him in a long but somewhat revealing red dress, her beautiful black hair waving slightly in the night breeze. She spots him immediately and waves with a twinkle in her eyes. Tony parks his car right underneath the hotel overhang, hops out, and opens the passenger door for the lady.
Anya, you're looking stunning this evening.
Not as striking as you are in that suit, Tony.
Anya winks at him with a little blush on her cheeks, and Mrs. Stark takes her hand, giving it a little kiss before she sits down in the Lamborghini. Tony returns to the driver's seat, and off they go, straight for La Russo's. They arrive at a decadent restaurant with not too much trouble. The place has a sleek and modern look to it, with tall and slender trees stretching right up to the tops of its beige walls. Tony opens the glass door for Anya, and the pair find themselves a table in the velvety red inside. A large and sparkly chandelier hangs above them, but Tony couldn't care less about his surroundings. All that was on his mind now is Anya.
So, what do we start with first? Business or pleasure?
In a place like this, it's hard not to think of pleasure. I've read so much about you. Tony Stark, the philanthropist, spending tens of millions each year on children's hospitals. Tony Stark, the brilliant inventor, single-handedly saving his company, reigning in new prosperity. Tony Stark, the playboy every woman wants.
Please, do go on.
But who's the real Tony Stark? The one deep down?
I'm just a man who wants to make the world a better place, no matter what I do. That's the real me. None of that other stuff really matters. Besides the women.
Well, Tony, you're making my world better already.
So what about you, Anya? How does a beautiful woman like you find herself working for Yokoyama?
It's not my dream job, but it pays well.
What is your dream job, then?
Ever since I was a kid, I wanted to be a painter. But most people can hardly make even a decent living off of it. And that's at least what my parents always told me. These days, I make more than they ever will.
Do you still paint?
Whenever I have free time, so not very often. I am working on something back at my room, though. I could show you later if you'd like. And maybe something else, too.
Oh, yeah? Right this way, man. What else do you want to show me?
Anya leans in closer to Tony, not taking her eyes off of him. Tony stares back lustfully. Before the two can say anything else, a flash of ginger hair catches Tony's eyes, and he looks to see Pepper in a stylish blue dress, followed closely by Happy Hogan in his finest tuxedo. The private moment is broken now as Tony turns his attention to Pepper.
Pepper? Happy? What are you doing here?
We're on a date, Tony. What? Are you the only one allowed to have a love life?
I thought you said you didn't need anyone.
Changed my mind. Why? You're not jealous now, are you?
Please. Who could be jealous of you?
Come on, Happy. Let's go find our table.
Yes, ma'am. Hi, Mr. Stark. Bye, Mr. Stark.
Pepper struts off just as Happy gives Tony an awkward wave before following after her. Tony watches them for a moment before returning his attention back to Anya, who now has a sly smile.
You like her, don't you?
What? Who?
The redhead, Pepper?
Of course I don't. She's a pain in my ass.
Please. I see how you reacted to her being here with another man. It's okay if you do. I don't mind.
Let's not talk about her right now. Tell me more about yourself.
Well...
Pepper and Happy sit down at a table not too far away from Tony and Anya, Pepper keeping an eye on the two of them to make sure Anya doesn't poe anything.
What would you like to drink tonight, ma'am?
Pepper tries to tune out the rest of the dinner crowd in hopes of maybe hearing what Anya and Tony are talking about. But there's too many people and they're too far away. Instead, she focuses on Anya's lips, trying to get a read of their conversation.
Pepper?
What? Yes, sorry. Red wine, please. Cheapest you got.
All right. And for the gentleman?
What she's having?
Two red wines coming up. Would you like any recommendations this evening?
We're fine, thanks.
Very well.
Oh, actually, what soup? And he's gone. Alrighty. Okay, So, Pepper, do you have a favorite movie?
I don't know. The Breakfast Club, I guess.
Wait, really? Wow. I thought you'd be more into dramas or stuff. You're always super serious. Not that anything's wrong with that. I mean, I like that. It's cool. And you have... It's cool that you have a fun side, too. I went out with this girl once who was obsessed with wine, and she made me order these drinks, and she walked out on me when I went to order, what was that, Pinot Noir, that, there it is. She said it wouldn't pair well with her dinner. I'm like, seriously? You walked out on me because of that?
Yeah, that's crazy. So what do you think about this Anya person Tony's with?
Oh, that woman from Yokoyama? Well, she's pretty hot. She's beautiful, and you're beautiful too, but you're more beautifuler than she is. But to tell you the truth, her eyes kind of creep me out.
Creep you out? Why?
There's just something about them. Like, they're pretty. Not prettier than yours, but there's some sort of darkness there. Like, she's seen some bad shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I guess I do. I overheard her talking to her boss, and she said something like, Tony doesn't suspect anything, and we'll have him in our grasp soon.
That is weird. Do you think she means that she'll get him to buy Yokoyama or something else?
That's what I'm trying to find out. I figured if I went undercover, maybe I could get a read on what she's planning.
Undercover? What? Wait a minute. Did you just ask me out to use me as your cover story?
Happy, you're a good guy, so you deserve the truth. Yes, I did ask you out as a cover. And maybe to make Tony a little jealous just for revenge.
Oh. I see.
But I'm having a really great time with you. Honest. This is the best date I've had in a year.
You know what? This is a pretty cool date, isn't it? Sort of like a James Bond 007 secret mission.
Exactly. Now just act normal, alright? I'll keep my eye on Takahashi.
Right. Normal. So, how about that weather?
Pepper gives Happy an amused smile while her eyes stay fixed on Tony and Anya's table. Anya continues talking to Tony, but notices Pepper staring at them out of the corner of her eye.
And even though I completely embarrassed myself on my first day as the Yokoyama American Ambassador, the company still accepted my offer. Pretty lucky, right?
Anya, you're incredible. I'm so glad you...
Tony's smartwatch lights up as I alert him that Obadiah Stane is attempting to call him. He looks down at it and back up at Anya.
I'm sorry. Would you mind if I...
Go right ahead. I understand.
Thanks.
Tony takes out an earpiece from his pocket and answers the call. What he doesn't notice, however, is that Anya fills with a clear earpiece of her own, so she too can hear the entire conversation.
Tony, I think I've got something for you. There's a guy in accounting, Morley Irwin, and his financial reports have been a little hinky. He's been careful not to draw attention to himself, but upon closer examination, there's something wrong. He's been funneling bits of profit into an unknown account. Now, who really knows if this is anything sinister, but it could be worth investigating.
Thanks, Obi. I'll get my friend on this.
No problem. So how's that business meeting going with Mrs. Takahashi?
Later, Obi. Anya, I hate to have to do this, but I need to go back to Stark Industries. Something urgent came up.
I know how busy of a life running a company is. Shall we pick this up tomorrow night? You could stop by my place, and I can make you dinner.
That would be lovely. Thanks for understanding.
I'll walk you out to your car. Don't worry about me, I'll just get a cab.
You sure?
It's no trouble at all, really.
I'll make it up to you.
I know you will.
Tony smiles at her before getting up from his seat and fishing out a few $100 bills to cover their drinks. Tony looks back at Anya, who's standing up at her seat too and smiling. She lightly grabs his arm, and together they begin walking out. Pepper watches them closely from the table, while Happy takes a big sip of his wine. Her eyes narrow when she notices something reflecting slightly in Anya's hand. Eyes widening when she realizes it's a needle.
Shit! Happy, stay right here! I think Anya's trying to drug Tony!
What?!
Just stay there!
Pepper rushes out of her chair to try and catch up with the pair, who are nearly out of the door. A few waiters block her path, and Miss Potts tries to weave through.
Excuse me! Pardon me! sorry, I need to go!
Anything I can help you with?
No, excuse me.
Pippa's heart is pounding as she momentarily loses sight of them when she reaches the parking lot. She's madly looking around, desperate to find Tony. Tony, on the other hand, simply strolls quietly to his car with Anya, unlocking her for the press of his watch.
Well, Anya, this was brief but lovely.
Anya gives Tony a long kiss goodbye, and they both close their eyes, seeming to enjoy it. Anya, however, has another motive. She jabs the needle into Tony's neck, and he breaks away from her.
Ouch! What? Anya! What did you...
Tony starts feeling nauseous right away, finding it hard to keep his footing. He stumbles down to the ground and looks at Anya, who has a terrifying smile on her face. His eyes shut. Anya snatches Tony's watch off of his wrist and crushes it in her hand, cutting me off completely from Mr. Stark. She hoists Tony's unconscious body into the back of her car, but before she can slam the door shut...
What the hell are you doing, you bitch?
Ah, the redhead. Pepper, was it? You shouldn't have butted in.
And you messed with the Huh. Oh my god.
Pepper didn't feel the needle that Lady Bullseye flung into the side of her neck, but it took full effect as Pepper crashed down. Lady Bullseye stoops down to her level and smiles as she picks up Pepper by her neck.
You're lucky I didn't kill you, bitch. I think you'll be perfect leverage, however. And when you're no longer useful, I'll carve you up slowly.
Lady Bullseye drags Pepper to the back of Tony and tosses her in. She shuts the door and drives off fast, following the plan she carefully crafted the night before, and heads to a getaway car miles away. Back in LaRusso's, Happy begins to worry.
I wake up briefly in a daze, trying to take in my surroundings as much as I can with my blurry vision. I think I'm on some sort of airplane, tied down tight. I feel my heart beat harder when I see another captive in front of me. Pepper. I try with all my might to break out of my restraints. Wait, duh, I'm Tony Stark. I look over at my wrist, hoping they didn't take my watch. Of course they did. Idiot.
Tazigla, Dalota!
I have no idea what the hell he said, but it can't be good. Brute strength it is, then. I tug at my restraints again, trying to get up and out of them. Rhodey was right. I really should have worked out more when I had the chance. One of the guards runs over to me with a needle in his hand. I'm not giving up this easily. I thrash around, doing my damnedest to not... Shit. I slowly start waking up again, this time in a completely different location, some sort of grimy and dimly lit warehouse. The place looks like a stiff wind would knock it all down. Once again, I'm tied to a chair, but my heart drops when I notice another difference. No sign of Pepper. I'm not alone though. A man in a suit with long black hair stands before me, something sinister shining in his eyes. There are a few guards behind him too. Weapons trained on me. Well, this isn't good.
Tony Stark. Nice to finally meet a member of the family who tried to destroy my life.
Being a little dramatic, aren't we? I have no idea who the hell you are. If you think for a second that I'm gonna do anything you want, you've got another thing coming.
No, Mr. Stark, I don't think. I know you will do anything I want. If you're not aware, we currently have one of your employees here too. But my assassin has told me she's more than just an employee. We're lucky to have her. She'll be returned to you unharmed if you comply. Lady Bullseye and her organization are not known for their mercy. I suggest you help me if you don't want her to be nothing more than a stain on the wall.
I think over my options. If I don't do whatever the hell this guy wants me to do, it's Pepper's life. If I do, I could be responsible for any number of atrocities this maniac's got planned. I don't have much of a choice, but maybe I can sabotage him along the way. I'll do whatever you want. Just leave Pepper out of this.
I'm so glad we can be civil about this. Do remember that Miss Potts' life is in your hands, however. You decide what will happen to her.
Yes, very civil. This creep walks over to my chair with a satisfied smile on his face, pulling out a knife from his belt and cutting through my bindings. I leap up on my feet, tempted to punch this bastard in the face. But the men currently pointing assault rifles at me make me rethink that.
Now, no need for that, please. Lower your weapons.
The soldiers hesitantly lower their weapons. Despite how civil he wants things to look, I know at a moment's notice if I do anything wrong, I'd get shot.
How rude of me. I've forgotten to introduce myself. You may call me the Mandarin.
The Mandarin? Like the fruit? Is that supposed to intimidate anyone?
Yes, it is an unusual name, but believe me, the reputation behind it is more than enough to bend my enemies to my will.
Oh, I'm sure. Now, what exactly did you mean by my family ruining your life? I've never heard of you, or seen you in any of Dad's notes.
I'm glad you asked. Stark Industries, a shining technological beacon, promising a better future. How did it get that way, though? Your birthright is built upon ashes and graves. We lifted you to the top, but not by choice. My village was enslaved and forced into a work camp when I was only 5 years old. My parents died when I was 7. I'm scarred, damaged, all from working for you. Yes, Stark Industries ran the camp. I helped build tens of thousands of your weapons each year.
Look, there are no words I can say that would make what happened better. But that wasn't me. I had no idea any of this was happening. And if I did, I would have stopped it immediately.
Idly standing by while not knowing what your company is responsible for isn't an excuse, Mr. Stark. It's just as terrible as doing it yourself. We were helpless, but I gave my people power, and here we are now. We've made our fortune by selling your weapons. One of the richest and most influential people on the planet is forced to work with me. How the tides have changed.
What do you want?
I need your help in finding these.
He holds his hands close to my face, and I see 3 simple rings resting on his fingers. You seriously did all of this bullshit just to find a few cheap pieces of jewelry? You're as dumb as you look.
No, Mr. Stark, not just a few simple rings. I suspected a Western man such as yourself would not be familiar with the tale of the 10 rings. These few small artifacts hold an unbelievable amount of power, each unique in their own way. How would you suggest we go about looking for them?
Well, if we can pin down on a specific element within these rings, that's rare enough. I can hack into our satellites to do a geological search and pinpoint the exact location of each of them. Pretty simple, really. I've done this before.
And what would you need to do this?
A mass spectrometer and access to a computer. But I assume you don't have any of that here in this dump.
You may be surprised what we can get our hands on. Give me a few hours. Guards, keep an eye on our guest.
Looks like I'm stuck here for a while. I just hope someone has noticed I'm missing.
Someone has indeed noticed. Happy Hogan currently tries to explain to Obadiah that both Tony and Pepe have disappeared without a trace. Obadiah, however, remembers all the times that Tony has disappeared and is very skeptical.
But Mr. Stane,
I'm sure Tony's fine, Happy. Do you have any idea how many times he's disappeared to one of his private islands with some supermodel for a few weeks? I've got work to do.
Ugh, God damn it! Why doesn't anybody take me seriously?
Something wrong, Happy?
It's Mr. Stark. Oh, hey, Rhodey. What are you doing here?
Tony and I were going out for lunch. But once again, it looks like he forgot.
He didn't forget. I'm pretty sure some Japanese businesswoman just kidnapped him.
Sounds like one of Tony's fantasies. Where did you see him last?
Well, Pepper and I may have sort of spied on him last night when he was at LaRusso's. Pepper ran off after him and left, and I waited for her to come back. I haven't seen them since. Oh, God. Oh, no. Do you think they're...
dead? No, I highly doubt that. Tony is worth way too much alive. If anything, someone wants a ransom off of him, but if that were the case, it would be all over the news by now. They obviously want something from him, but...
of course, obviously, yeah. That's exactly what I was thinking.
Happy, can you give me access to Jarvis? I think I know a way to find them.
Follow me. Mr. Stark's office has what you need.
Happy and Rhodey quickly dash off to Tony's office, knowing that time is ticking. Happy jiggles the handle once they reach the door, but it won't budge.
Damn it! It's locked. We need to find a janitor or something.
No, we don't. Step aside.
Happy gives Rhodey a curious look and shrugs, stepping out of the way of Colonel Rhodes. Rhodey slams his shoulder against the door and he's locked off its hinges.
Holy shit!
What'll Mr. Stark think when he gets back?
He's rich. He can get another door.
Happy and Rhodey walk into Mr. Stark's office. Happy, more hesitant. The lights flicker on and Rhodey walks past the mess Tony left on the floor. There is blueprints and note cards all over the place. Typical Tony. He flips open his laptop and presses his finger on the mouse pad, hoping it'll unlock. To his slight surprise, the screen unlocks. Hello, Mr. Rhodes. How may I be of service?
Jarvis, Tony is missing. We need your help finding him.
Yes. His watch went offline last night. I assumed you did not require me. However, it seems I am wrong.
Who knows where he could be by now. We need to do some sort of scan. Is there any chance you can scan the entire world?
Most certainly, sir. However, without a specific geographical range, it will perhaps take hours to search for his DNA signature. Processing. Might I suggest starting in Asia? Iron Man has been running an investigation on a Chinese manufacturer. Perhaps the two could be linked.
Get to it then, whatever finds Tony the quickest.
One moment, sir. I hijack a collection of Stark satellites in the atmosphere and begin my scan. Rhodey and Happy wait as patiently as possible while I do so. Happy begins glancing over Tony's blueprints, while Rhodey taps his foot, watching my progress on the laptop. At last, after 50 minutes, I find Mr. Stark. Here is the exact coordinates of Mr. Stark's current location.
Good work, Jarvis. Your hunch was right. We gotta get somebody down there quick. Who knows what sort of trouble Tony is in.
Who should we call to rescue them? The Army? The Marines? The Coast Guard? Thor?
Happy? I think I have a better idea.
Rhodey walks out of Tony's office smiling to himself, leaving Happy in the dark.
The Mandarin and a few of his goons come back with the exact pieces of equipment I need. I can't deny that I'm impressed they actually got it all, and fast too. The goons begin setting it all up, and the Mandarin grins slightly, as if saying, "Told you so." I need to draw this out as much as possible. And luckily for me, I'm an expert bullshitter.
Everything will be ready momentarily, Mr. Stark. You'll be free in no time. If you do exactly as I say.
Oh, sure. I totally believe you. I've gotta ask, why are you still making Stark weapons anyways? Trying to smear my name out of revenge? I wouldn't be surprised if you stole all of this from us, too.
It does please me knowing that your great company is doing something you thoroughly disagree with, but that is not the reason. Though clearly what we are doing is illegal, I'm trying to bring some legitimacy to my operation. If nothing else, to draw away suspicion. All of these rings I have were purchased or found, not stolen. Purchased with laundered money, yes, but some things must be done for the benefit of the world.
How noble of you. How are these rings going to change the world anyways?
You will see, in time. But everything I will do with them is for the better. The world is riddled with greed and poverty, two problems that should not exist together. The 1% sit on a solution but are too stingy to even care, frivolously spending on themselves while those who need it are left to fight starving on the streets for their survival. This will change all of that. Consider me the Robin Hood, for a simple metaphor. With these rings, I will equalize the balance. No one will be left ignored, and everyone will live well.
Steal from the rich and give to the poor? I'm not saying you're wrong, but there's gotta be a better solution than what? Bullying billionaires out of their money?
Unfortunately, the only way people will listen is through threats and violence. Sad truth. Would you help me if I did not threaten yours and Pepper's lives?
Hell no. Because you're insane.
Sanity is subjective, Mr. Stark. Some might call me a hero for what I'm about to do. However, doing the right thing no matter what anyone thinks is what's important. Now, everything is ready for you. Begin your work.
The Mandarin slips off one of his fancy rings and hands it over to me. Part of me wonders what'd happen if I put it on. But I'm pretty sure the answer is that the minute it touches my finger, I'd get a bullet shower. I could definitely use a shower right now, but not that kind. I place the ring in the mass spectrometer and press a few buttons on the machine, then let it do its thing. This is the boring part. Waiting. Should take about an hour to analyze.
Time is of no matter to me. I've waited years for these rings. What's a few hours?
You sure about that?
It seems we have a visitor. To be expected. Guards, take care of them.
A set of guards nods and runs off toward the sound of the explosion. Wonder who came to my rescue anyways. Maybe the Avengers finally got off their asses and started doing something again.
I can see the hope in your eyes. It'll be satisfying seeing it crushed when we kill this insurgent.
I'd like to see you try. You're in for a world of hurt, pal.
The Mandarin's guards rush to the entrance of their base, surprised when they find a massive hole waiting for them. But the they're not alone. A pair of glowing eyes stares at them. The rubble and smoke dissipates. A man in a silver and gray suit of armor with a briefcase in his hand stands right in front of them. They waste no time firing at the man, hoping their bullets would pierce his suit. The men were hoping for too much. Instead of even scratching war machines on, bullets ricochet every which way. The guard stuck out of the way, shocked, and now filled with fear.
That's seriously all you got? Henchmen these days are just getting worse and worse, aren't they?
War machine lets out a spray of bullets from the back turret, imparting the thugs with precision and accuracy. Rhodey smiles to himself underneath his helmet, having a feeling that saving Tony will be a cinch. This is just the beginning, however.
It seems your savior is a worthy opponent, at least for my guards. He's yet to face Lady Bullseye, however.
War machine speeds through the complex base, hardly paying attention to the hornet's puffing and bullets. He uses his x-ray setting to look through the walls, attempting to find his friend, and having little luck thus far.
Jarvis, scan for Tony's DNA signature.
Scanning. Mr. Stark seems to be at the heart of the base, sir.
Block the fastest way to him.
Loading a course now in the hub.
Hang on, Tony, I'm coming.
Rhodey increases speed, strategically blasting through walls while paying attention to the structural integrity of the building, not wanting to crush Tony before saving him. Rhodey draws closer to the target, and is surprised to see another friend locked up in the warehouse.
Pepper?
Pepper stares at War Machine, eyes wide and is tied to a chair in a dimly lit room. She lets out muffled yells, Rhodey assuming she's excited that she's being saved. War Machine steps closer when suddenly, a figure jumps out from the ceiling and lands on top of him. Pepper's yells with warning cries. Lady Bullseye jams a knife in between the plating of Rhodey's shoulder. War Machine slams his back on the wall, but she's still locked onto him. He bashes Lady Bullseye into the wall again and again. This time she really starts to feel the hits. The assassin at last lets go of Rhodey and tumbles down to the ground. War Machine takes the opportunity to fire a precise laser at Pepper's binders, and she's free at last. Rhodey slides the suitcase to her as she gets out of the chair and rubs her wrists.
Pepper, get that ah!
Matsumoto isn't out of the fight just yet. She stabs one of her daggers into War Machine's leg, looking up at him with a frenzied, bloodied smile. Pepper scoops up the suitcase and worriedly looks back at Rhodey for a moment. Scared he's in over his head. War Machine simply nods, telling her to go to Tony. Rhodey punches Lady Bullseye in the face, and a sickening crack reverberates. Though blood leaks from a broken nose, the assassin doesn't give up. She throws a knife at the fleeing Pepper. Rhodey's heart stops as he sees it spinning dangerously fast towards the redhead. He acts in a flash, flying at the dagger, trying to get a lock on it. War Machine dives in front of it, a foot away from Pepper, and it stabs into his arc reactor, shutting his suit down and sitting sprawling on the floor.
War Machine!
Pepper, go! Go! Get to Tony!
A tear stings Pepper's eye as she does as she's told, running away before Lady Bullseye sends another knife away.
You and I are going to have a lot of fun, Tin Man. First, I'll peel that armor off. Then, your skin.
Back in the main room, the Mandarin waits patiently for the mass spectrometer to finish, having faith that Lady Bullseye will be more than enough to hold back whoever's infiltrated his base.
Enjoy your freedom while you can. Time's ticking.
I recommend the same for you, Mr. Stark. This proves that perhaps keeping you alive is too dangerous. Unfortunate.
Pepper abruptly walks onto the scene with Rhodey's briefcase in hand. Tony's eyes widen and a smile touches his face when he sees that she's alright. Before the Mandarin can react, Pepper slides the briefcase to Tony at once. Tony recognizes it instantly and opens it up. His portable Iron Man suit suddenly wraps itself around his body in a hurry. Iron Man's eyes and arc reactor glowing. The Mandarin is in trouble now.
There is one thing that you should know about. I'm Iron Man.
Your modern technology is no match for the mystic arts.
Pepper runs for cover just as Iron Man fires a concentrated energy blast at Mandarin's chest. He blocks it with a magic force field. Before Tony can fire another attack, the Mandarin sends out a vicious wave of energy. Iron Man narrowly dodges it, but gets knocked on his back by yet another unrelenting spell. Tony tries to get up, but the Mandarin holds him down with his magic.
So blinded by your ego and overconfidence, you can't see when you're bested.
The Mandarin turns his head. Tony's armor begins to deconstruct around him, its faceplate separating and showing its concerned face. Before his gauntlet shuts apart, Tony fires a last ditch repulsive blast at the Mandarin, skirting him away. The spell breaks, and Iron Man's armor falls back into place.
Speaking of ego,
Tony, feeling a surge of what he thinks is the tide changing, fires repulsive blast after repulsive blast at the Mandarin. The first two hit their mark yet again, but the Mandarin takes the brunt of the blow and even starts curving them around him. Tony tries something more deadly, launching a missile straight for the Mandarin's chest. The Mandarin was ready for it, however. He wills it past his body and swings it back at Iron Man. Tony quickly fires a repulsive blast at it, but it's too close.
God damn it!
Back in the other interrogation room, Rhodey's not faring much better in his situation. Lady Bullseye shatters his armor and uses her sharpest knife to begin cutting through the War Machine armor with surgical precision. Rhodey feels the integrity of his armor starting to give way.
Oh, how pathetic. You're just a weak man hiding behind your armor.
Sure about that?
Rhodey takes this brief moment while Lady Bullseye is distracted to launch into action. He activates the suit's manual release, causing the assassin to be flung hard to the ground. Rhodey kicks the knife out of her hand, drags Lady Bullseye off the ground, and gets her in a chokehold.
Not so defenseless now, am I?
I wouldn't say that.
Lady Bullseye kicks Rhodey hard in the knee, and he winces in pain, trying to keep his iron grip on her neck. During this hasty attack, Lady Bullseye got her hands on another knife. Before Rhodey realizes this fact, she jabs it in his arm, and his grip is broken. Rhodey painfully rips the knife from his arm and gets into a combat stance. Lady Bullseye drawing yet another knife and doing the same.
You really think you can win this? Do you know how lethal my aim is? I never miss.
Then why don't you just kill me now? You're so confident.
I like to have fun with my prey.
Tony recovers after the blow from his own missile and thinks of a different tactic.
Jarvis, target his rings.
On it, sir. While I pinpoint the tiny targets, the Mandarin does not cease his attack. He wasn't letting Iron Man get in the way of his important plans. The Mandarin focuses energy on Iron Man's helmet, disassembling it with ease.
No matter how invincible you think you are, you're still just a man!
And so are you. Jarvis, now!
While the Mandarin is distracted, I fire a concentrated laser blast on his finger, slicing it off clean. The Mandarin stops deconstructing Tony's helmet immediately and swoops over the ground to retrieve the ring from his severed finger. Iron Man acts fast, however, slamming him into the back wall.
You're really starting to piss me off.
The feeling's mutual.
Rage fills the Mandarin's eyes. His cool under fire and gentlemanly facade is gone. Iron Man presses the powerful man into the wall harder, raising his arm up to aim another shot at the Mandarin's fingers. The Mandarin doesn't allow it.
That's enough!
A massive energy blast emanates from his open mouth, slamming Iron Man back into the opposite wall, and even shaking the entire warehouse. Lady Bullseye and Rhodey feel the earthquake, keeping their balance as they spar. Rhodey tries to stab his knife into a leg, but instead gets a kick to the head. His vision is momentarily blurred, but he's still conscious enough to block an almost fatal knife stab to the heart. Rhodey cuts at her hand, and although the knife tumbles out of her palm, Lady Bullseye shows no sign that it hurt her. Rhodes tries to stab her neck, hoping to end the fight soon, but he has no such luck. Matsumoto takes the knife in her hand, without second consideration, stabs it into the colonel's side.
I'm mildly impressed. You put up a decent fight. But now, it's time we end this.
Just before Lady Bullseye can stab the knife into Rhodey's skull, he acts on instinct. Rhodey kicks Matsumoto hard in the crotch, praying she's human enough to feel that. She does. She starts rolling back off of Rhodey. He knows he doesn't have long, so Colonel Rhodes takes her down while he can. He punches her hard in the stomach while she's down, then delivers a final blow to her head. Lady Bullseye slumps to the ground. She's out cold. Rhodey painfully lifts her up and slams her down into the chair that once held Miss Potts. He spots a spare spool of cord on the ground close by and ties up Matsumoto tightly. Rhodey makes sure Lady Bullseye is secure one last time before scooping up his war machine glove and running off to help Tony. Protecting two broken ribs.
Yeah, I know.
Iron Man gets back up off the ground after a parting from the Mandarin, armor really starting to crack under the pressure. The Mandarin levitates in front of Tony, boiling with rage.
Like I said, Stark, you're still a man, and every man has a heart.
The Mandarin snatches Pepper from her cover and holds her up in the air, choking her with magic.
Pepper! You put her down, you son of a bitch!
She'll only be spared if you take off your armor and surrender! You think choking her to death is the only thing I can do with my powers? No, I can give her a far more painful death, and I'll make sure you watch every second of it!
No! I'll take off the suit! Just stop this!
Tony doesn't see a way out of this. He has no choice. He takes off his helmet and tosses it to the ground. He looks up at Pepper, who's terrified, but shaking her head. Tony stares back at her, sorrow in his eyes. He couldn't sacrifice Pepper. He knew it would tear him up inside if she died because of him. He rips off his chest plate, and the Mandarin smiles sinisterly at the crestfallen Stark. He's surprised, however, to find out that his faith in Lady Bullseye was misplaced. Rhodey runs in, and without a second notice, fires a repulsive blast at the Mandarin's chest. Both he and Pepper fall to the ground, winded and hurt, but still alive. Without hesitation, Iron Man runs over and rips the rings off of the Mandarin's fingers before he can react.
You're done, Mandarin. You made a mistake crossing me. You're nothing without your rings.
No, Mr. Stark. You made a mistake crossing me and my organization. This is not the end.
Man, I am so sick of this shit.
You all right, pal?
I'll live. Tony, you've got a crazy taste in women, my friend.
That Japanese girl was a real killer bitch.
You're telling me? How'd you find us anyways?
Jarvis and Happy helped me. You know, Happy was the only person who thought you two were in danger.
I owe that man a big raise. Thanks for the save, Rhodey.
Hey, it's what I do. So, what happens now? We hand this guy over to the Chinese police?
No. Call S.H.I.E.L.D. They'll know what to do.
Rhodey nods and pulls out his phone while Pepper gingerly gets up off the ground. Tony runs over to help her.
Thanks.
Pepper, I'm so sorry I got you in this mess. Are you alright?
I'm fine. Then, hey. It was my fault for getting myself into this anyways. I was stupid enough to try to save you myself.
Even after how much of an ass I was?
Yeah, well, that's my job. No matter how much of an ass you are.
I promise. Going forward, I'll try to keep my assery down to a minimum. I'm sorry about that, too. I had no right to say anything I said back in the lobby. I was being a dick.
You were, yes. But maybe it wasn't entirely false.
Wait, does that mean that you...
Does that answer your question?
Wow. You, wanna stick around here for a few hours?
Not exactly the most romantic place, is it?
True. Ever been to Spain?
Never.
Rhodey, you good babysitting this guy for a little bit?
Hey, what a friend for. Go relax a little. More than earned it.
Thanks, Rhodey. Hang on.
Pippa wraps her arms tightly around Tony's stock, and together they take off and fly through the night sky. Tony thankful for every second Pepper parts into his arms.
Lady, when you're with me, I'm smiling. Give me all your love. Your hands build me up when I'm sinking. Just touch me and my troubles all fade. Lady, from the moment I saw you, standing, oh, 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 you gave all the love that I needed. So shy, like a child who had grown.
S.H.I.E.L.D. arrives on the scene of Iron Man and Mandarin's intense battle less than 20 minutes after Tony and Pepper leave on their romantic rendezvous. The Mandarin and all of his soldiers are carted off to an undisclosed location, along with his three powerful rooms. Maria Hill oversees the entire operation, keeping an eye on the chained up Mandarin while questioning Rhodey.
So, these rings were the source of his power, right?
Yeah. He didn't seem to have any powers of his own once Tony took off the rings.
That makes things easier. Now, you said there was some sort of female assassin here, too.
She's tied up in the other room. You guys didn't arrest her already?
We didn't see anyone in the other room. Just an empty chair.
Inside a cafe in San Diego, Lady Bullseye finds herself alone in a booth, this time not in her typical assassin outfit, but looking normal in street clothes. A TV is on in the background, detailing the latest happenings at Stark Industries.
Morley Erwin, an employee of 7 years at Stark Industries, has been arrested for collusion with a very secretive terrorist organization. Not much has been given on his misdeeds except for the fact that he had been leaking information to this dangerous group for months. It is likely he will face a life sentence.
Here's your coffee. Would you like anything else? Our blueberry scones are made fresh daily.
Thanks, but I'll stick with the coffee.
Well, alright. Just let me know if you want anything more. Lady Bullseye smiles sweetly at the waiter as he heads for another table. The smile disappears instantly as she pulls out a flip phone and dials a number.
I evaded capture, but they got the Mandarin. He won't speak of any of this. He knows I'm still out there, sir. I apologize that things didn't go as planned. It won't happen again. You can still trust the hand to do your bidding.
No matter. I didn't expect his plan to work anyway. It was a fool's gambit. I've got something I'll bury Stark for good.
Obadiah Stane finishes up typing an email to Tony Stark, entitled, Urgent, New Blueprint from Howard's Files. The contents of the email are plain enough, Stane leaving a simple message saying, might be something to look into, attached with a document. The document in question is entitled, Project Ultron.